Good morning. I'm Liz Loomis. I'm today's deacon at First Parish Church Congregational in Manchester-by-the-Sea, Massachusetts. And it is my pleasure and privilege to welcome you here to our spiritual community's weekly time of remembrance, worship, and recommitment to God and God's ways as best expressed for us in the Christian spiritual tradition through the life of Jesus of Nazareth. First Parish Church Congregational, the congregational part of our name signifying our long-standing tradition within Christianity of democratic governance and the full equality of all members of the spiritual community to participate in its life and work. This means that I welcome you here this morning, whether you are here in person or watching from elsewhere, to this place where no matter who you are or where you are on your life or faith journey, you are fully and completely welcome. Once again, we have the pleasure of having Ellie Richardson as our pastor this morning, and we welcome her. I'm going to turn it over to you.
Thank you, Liz. I appreciate this, and it's always a joy and pleasure to be with you on a Sunday morning. Welcome on this beautiful fall day. The air is a little bit crisp, but it is lovely outside. We are blessed to live in a place where we can see the seasons change and have the joy of fresh air and clean water. I invite you now to take a breath. Close your eyes if you would like, but just take a deep breath. Breathe in the Holy Spirit. Let that breath go to your fingers and your toes, swirl around your heart, and breathe out. One more breath in, and let that Spirit fill you. And as you breathe out any stress you may feel, any busyness that instilled itself in your day before you arrived here. Turn it over to God. God will hold whatever you need God to hold for the next hour. And at the end of that hour, you can ask for it back or not. Please join me in our call to worship printed in the bulletin. Beloved people of God, come to the wedding feast of life. Leave your labors and burdens and come. There's no worthiness or unworthiness, only that you're invited. Come hungry for grace and ready to celebrate. We come with joy to worship. Alleluia. I invite you now to stand in body or spirit and sing our opening hymn, Praise to the Living God, number 8 in the New Century Hymnal.
Thank you.
As we come to our prayer time this morning, I invite you to share your joys and concerns. I'm not sure who has the microphone this morning. That will go around and help so we can all hear what your prayer requests are this day. We're finding the microphone. Does anybody have a concern they would like to lift up this morning?
Okay, go ahead. Since I'm up here already with the microphone, I'd just like to say thank you to everybody for everything you're doing for Jerry and I.
Thank you, Mary Ellen. Anyone else have a concern or a joy down front? Yes.
I think you may remember last Sunday, I mentioned the young lady who is the granddaughter of my long, long, long time dear friend in Chicago, Gloria Ann Engerman. I have on my heart and concern that came to me this week of her family, her mother and father in Chicago, her grandmother, my dear friend, and all her other extended family and the Engerman family, worried to the extreme point in anxiety for what will become of her in Israel. Apparently, for the time being, she plans to stay there and in northern Israel. and very idealistic, and she has long since wanted to put her energies and her talents and her life in Israel, and she was, will remain for the time being at least. But of course, it reminds me of many, many, many families all across this country who have loved ones in that part of the world, worried very, very seriously. My heart goes out to all of them, and particularly to this Engerman family, my dear friends. I hope you can join me in that support for the anxiety and the worry and concerns about what is happening to their loved ones.
Amen. Thank you.
Other joys or concerns this morning? No birthdays or anniversaries to celebrate? It's a quiet week. Oh, yes, we have down here.
I'm not sure if I need the mic. Oh, online.
Yep, the people that are up and looking at us through the camera.
I just want to say that Penny and I are very happy to have the young lady sitting next to me in the same pew, and that she has returned from the Washington area, and she now resides in her house in Manchester, I don't need to say, by the sea, near us. And it's a great pleasure to have her, and she's a help to us, because we're not getting any younger. Thank you, Beck.
I'm sorry, I didn't catch your name. Is it Becca? Becca. Welcome back, Becca. Any others? I don't see any hands being raised. As we prepare for prayer this morning, Marin Terabasi, who is a clergy colleague and an author, posted a psalm for today. And it's based on the 23rd psalm, and I would like to share it with you before we pray. God is the shepherd of Israel and Palestine, a people who want peace and fear war. God is a child desperate for water and a family terrified for precious hostages. God is in all souls. God waits on every path. This week, the valley of the shadow of death is crowded with God's children, and they have no comfort but our prayers, the prayers of the world, for a table where enemies may sit down to speak healing words, receive an anointing of truce, and shatter the cup of death before it is poured out on those who are innocent. Goodness and mercy will follow us even in these days of fear and grieving, until we build a house of reconciliation and dwell in it together. Please join me in prayer. Holy and loving God, we come to you with prayers of concern for loved ones, for friends, for our country and the world. We cry out and lament because we feel helpless. We pray for innocent people caught up in conflicts not of their creation and beyond their control. May they feel and be strengthened by your presence. And we acknowledge that in the midst of the turmoil, there are joys that have been shared. Family returned. Joy that we can come together in this sacred place and worship you. And we are grateful that in the midst of uncertainties and contradictions, your light shines through the darkness, bringing hope for the future. We pray for First Parish Church, its leaders and the congregation, as they prepare to welcome a new settled pastor. And we pray for Reverend Catherine and Old South as they complete their ministry together. Pour out your blessings upon them all as they transition to new futures, living the mission and ministry of Jesus together. In these days when there are so many distractions, help us to be the church and share your radical love and compassion everywhere we go. Hear us now as we lift our voices together, praying the prayer that Jesus taught the disciples, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Mary Ellen has a few words to share with us about the annual fund drive this morning.
Good morning, everybody. Some people are probably saying, it's the middle of October, Mary Ellen's up. So it's the beginning of our fund drive, the middle of October, and we follow my introduction with a few weeks of testimonials from members of our congregation. I'd like to say that our congregation gives all year round. I consider us a very generous church, but we do call the fall up to through December our season of giving. So we look for our annual pledge for 2024 at this time. And anyone that's new to the church, I'm always available to talk about what pledging is, but I won't bother everyone else about that. So when we start the pledge drive, my committee gets together and usually we ask the minister, well, lately we haven't had that, so what my committee has come up with a theme or a Bible quote. So this time I reached out to Bethany and I said, do you think you could talk to Reverend Catherine to see if she would like some input into our fund drive and maybe come up with a theme or a Bible verse for us? So Bethany did, and Catherine had two choices, and Bethany and I both decided we loved the second choice. Wait till you hear it. So 1 Thessalonians 5:11. Therefore, encourage one another and build up each other, as indeed you are doing. When I read that, I went, seriously? I mean, really? We've been running the church for how many years now? Building each other up for how many years now? It couldn't be a better quotation. So as I was thinking about it, I've been a member for 40 years. There's so many wonderful things that have happened in the past, and so many wonderful things are happening right now. And people, like the love that my family has felt in our tragic times right now, amazing, and that will continue forever. But as we're heading forth with a new minister and a new year and just so many hopes and dreams, I hope we can put away the quotes of, we never did it this way, oh, that's not the way we do it. I remember when. I'd like us to get rid of some of those so that when we're together talking, we can think of new opportunities. So I want you to close your eyes, and online, close your eyes for a minute, and I want everyone to think about this question. What are your dreams for the future we are building together at First Parish? And I hope that you keep thinking about that as we enter into our fund drive. Thank you.
Thank you, Mary Ellen. And thank you for reaching out to Reverend Catherine and including her this quote from Scripture. From the little bit I know about you and I've experienced with you over the last couple of months, you are living this. So it is. It's perfect for you. So as we prepare to receive the offering this morning, know that we have all been blessed with gifts of the Spirit, financial gifts, and whatever you're able to give, God will multiply it many times to do the work of this church, in this community, and in the world. The morning offering will now be received. Thank you. I invite you to join me in the prayer of dedication. God of peace, we're confronted with so many overwhelming needs in our world. Walk with us as we set aside our own desires and wants and join the call to alleviate human suffering. Transform these gifts into genuine acts of concern and ministry to others. In the name of the one who surpasses all understanding, we pray. Amen.
The scripture reading this morning is from Matthew 22, verses 1 to 14. Once more, Jesus spoke to them in parables, saying, "The kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who gave a wedding banquet for his son. He sent his slaves to call those who had been invited to the wedding banquet, but they would not come. Again, he sent other slaves, saying, 'Tell those who have been invited, look, I have prepared my dinner, my oxen and my fat calves have been slaughtered, and everything is ready. Come to the wedding banquet.' But they made light of it and went away, one to his farm, another to his business, while the rest seized his slaves, mistreated them, and killed them. The king was enraged. He sent his troops, destroyed those murderers, and burned their city. Then he said to his slaves, 'The wedding is ready, but those invited were not worthy. Go, therefore, into the main streets and invite everyone you find to the wedding banquet.' Those slaves went out into the streets and gathered all whom they found, both good and bad, so the wedding hall was filled with guests. But when the king came in to see the guests, he noticed a man there who was not wearing a wedding robe. And he said to him, 'Friend, how did you get in here without a wedding robe?' And he was speechless. Then the king said to the attendants, 'Bind him hand and foot and throw him into the outer darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. For many are called, but few are chosen.'"
Thank you, Liz. Please pray with me. Holy and loving God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts, this and every day, be acceptable in your sight, for you are our strength, our rock, and our Redeemer. Amen. Okay, here we are again, still with Jesus in Jerusalem, those last few days of his life. The Pharisees are still trying to trick Jesus so they can arrest him. And Jesus provides another really challenging parable for us to wrestle with. If what we hear in the gospel today is really what the kingdom of heaven is like, I am not interested. Forget it. Who needs God's kingdom, at least as Jesus describes it today, when we already have more than enough leaders throughout the world who are abusing their power? When violence is perpetrated on a daily basis, when violence and people's lives are being destroyed, when cities are burning and when some are excluded and told they do not belong. We don't need God's help to bring that about. Tragically, we're pretty good at that all by ourselves. So let me ask you this. Does today's gospel fit your image of the kingdom of heaven? Is that what you're seeking when you come to church on a Sunday morning? Is the way Jesus describes the kingdom what you have in mind when you pray, "Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven"? And if it is, who are you praying that it be done to? Yourself? Someone else? This is a very difficult and painful text, especially this week with what's happening in the world. It feels like there's something left unwritten that we aren't reading, like there's something left unspoken that we aren't hearing. There are just too many contradictions and inconsistencies to take it at face value. If today's gospel teaches us anything, it's that we can't simply hear or read scripture and glibly respond to it, thanks be to God, or amen. Every text invites us to struggle not just with the text itself, but with the text in our lives, and to work out our faith in light of that struggle. And that's what I want us to do with today's gospel. I want us to wrestle and argue with this gospel until it begins to take shape in a way that reshapes our lives. It would have been much easier to use the Philippians passage or Psalm 23. That would have almost been easy compared to this. So I ask you, how do you like the image of a wedding banquet as the kingdom? Joy, love, feasting, family, the unity of two becoming one. Does that work for you? I'm good with that. It's the kind of thing I want for you and for myself. And it fits nicely with Jesus performing his first miracle at the wedding feast in Cana. It's consistent with the words in the book of Isaiah that the Lord will make for all people a feast of rich food, a feast of well-aged wines. And it echoes the psalmist saying that the Lord spread a table before him and filled it and filled his cup to overflowing. But look what happens next. The king sends messengers to tell those who had been invited, dinner's ready, come on, let's get this party started. But those who had been invited didn't come. They mistreated and killed the messengers. And then the king sent his army to destroy those who had been invited and burned their city to the ground. How about that for an image of the kingdom? Is that your experience of God? Are we going back to an eye for an eye? Is that what you want to teach your children and grandchildren about God? Is that what you're praying for when you pray the Lord's Prayer? And if that's the kingdom, then what do we do with thou shalt not murder, turn the other cheek, love your enemies? Or Isaiah telling us that the Lord will swallow up death forever and wipe away the tears from all faces. There has to be more to this story than what it says. Next, the king sends messengers to invite anyone, everyone, good or bad. And it's as if they're saying, it doesn't matter who you are or what you've done, this peace is for you, come on down. And that matches all the stories we've heard about Jesus. Eating and spending time with tax collectors and sinners, healing lepers, forgiving the woman caught in adultery, giving sight to the blind and life to the deaf, to the dead. That sounds more like the kingdom to me. How about you? What do you think? I can't help but think of other passages in Scripture like those in Philippians, which is also one of our Revised Common Lectionary readings for today, where Paul says, rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I say rejoice. Do not worry about anything. The Lord is near. And I also remember Jesus saying, do not be afraid. I come that you may have life and you may have it abundantly. My peace I give to you. The kingdom is for everyone. No one gets left out. All is well. That sounds good. But then a man shows up without a wedding robe. He survived the king's army, escaped the burning of his city, and accepted the invitation only to be thrown into the outer darkness because he wasn't properly dressed. Is there really a dress code for the kingdom? How many times have I heard people saying when they see a teenager show up in shorts and sneakers that they aren't properly dressed? Is that what you believe the kingdom is all about? And why didn't the king give the poor guy a wedding robe? He must have had a spare one in his closet. After all, didn't Jesus say something about welcoming the stranger and clothing the naked? So which is it? Welcome and clothe the stranger or kick him out because they're not properly dressed? Today's gospel is a collage of contradictions and inconsistency. a wedding banquet, and a bloodbath. Messengers of good news and truth and killers of those messengers. An enraged king that sends troops to destroy his own people. An open invitation to all and the exclusion of one who accepts the invitation. I sure hope there's more to the kingdom than that, don't you? Because today's gospel sounds more like headline news than good news. And yet we can't just turn away from today's gospel. It's asking something from us. To ignore or gloss over the contradictions and inconsistencies in today's gospel is to ignore or gloss over the contradictions and inconsistency in each of our own lives and in the world. I don't want to do that, and I hope you don't either. Let's face up to ourselves. Let's look at what is and imagine what could be. The contradictions and inconsistencies in our lives, our country, and the world today are telling us something has been lost, that things are not right, that we're sabotaging the life we say we want and the values we claim to hold. We're betraying ourselves, one another, and the kingdom. Today's gospel is a mirror reflecting all the contradictions and inconsistencies of our lives and the world. I wonder what those contradictions and inconsistencies today's gospel is showing you about yourself, about our country, about the world, and the ways in which we treat each other. What's missing? What's not right? What is it asking you to wrestle with? What is it asking us as a nation to wrestle with? I wonder if Jesus is telling this parable and hoping to shake us up, hoping to wake us up. I wonder if he's hoping that we'll say, "No, Jesus, we've followed your life. We've listened to your words. We've seen what you do. We know there is more to the kingdom than that." Do you look at the world today and think, there has to be more than this? Do you hear the cries of people and say to yourself, there's got to be more than this? Do you look at the brokenness, the injustice, the hurt, and say to yourself, we can do better than this? If you do, you're absolutely correct. I think we all want that kingdom. I think that's why we showed up today and why we keep showing up every Sunday. And I think that's why you and I struggle with these texts. I think that's why we say our prayers and weep. We've heard the call of something more. What's that more for you? What does that more look like in the face of one that has been excluded and told they don't belong? What is that more amidst violence and killing? What would more be when power is abused and people are hurt and oppressed? What would more look like when we turn on one another? How would more respond when we say things like, that's not my problem? They got what they deserve. Why should I care or get involved? What would the more of the kingdom look like in your life, in your relationship, in the conflicts and struggles you have with others? What does the more of that kingdom ask of you in the criticisms and doubts you have of yourself and others? What would that more offer when you feel overwhelmed and lost? I think that more would be the real kingdom of heaven. The one that's been lost, the one that needs to be recovered. It's the kingdom that speaks of love, compassion, forgiveness, mercy, kindness, beauty, and hope. If that's truly what we want, if that really is what we seek when we pray, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven, then you and I must become those things. It's up to us to be the more for each other and for the life of the world. More begins with each individual, and like a pebble in the pond, more will radiate out to embrace and lift each other up into the kingdom as we share God's radical love and compassion. and the world. I pray that it may be so. Amen.
There is a balm in Gilead to make the wounded whole. There is a balm in Gilead to heal the sin-sick soul.
There is a balm.
There is a balm.
Thank you, choir. We need that balm. Please rise in body and spirit as you are able for our closing hymn, number 407, How Firm a Foundation. As you prepare to leave this place today, may God bless and keep you. May God's face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May God look upon you with kindness and grant you peace, now and forevermore. Go from these doors this day and be the church wherever you go, whether it's at home, at school, at work, on the playground, by the ocean. Be the church. Be that radical love and compassion that God has for each and every soul. Go in peace, knowing you're a beloved child of God every day of your life. Amen.